Hello friends, once again welcome to NIOS Studio. Myself, Dr. Yukti Sharma, Department of Education, University of Delhi, is today going to discuss with you children with special needs, hearing and speech impairment. You all must be familiar with this clip, and this clip is of the news for the hearing impairment which is telecasted in the DD News, and this is how we relate with these people and also the sign language that they use. A very interesting fact is that the RPWD Act, Rights of Persons with Disability Act 2016, has reiterated it by saying that ensuring that persons with hearing impairment can have access to television programs with sign language interpretation or subtitles. The same act defines hearing impairment as deaf means persons having 70 decibels hearing loss in speech frequencies in both ears, and hard of hearing means persons having 60 decibels to 70 decibel hearing loss in speech frequencies in both ears. Now, some facts about children with hearing impairment. 4 in every 1,000 children suffer from severe to profound hearing loss. With over 1 lakh babies that are born with hearing deficiency every year, the National Sample Survey 58th Round 2002 surveyed disability in Indian households and found that hearing disability was the second most common cause of disability. So as we can see that there are many children in our country who are having hearing impairment, and we are making many initiatives, like this picture shows that some children using sign language are singing the national anthem of our country. So these initiatives and these identification of children has to keep going on at the level of the teachers also. For that, we need to understand who are children with hearing impairment in my classroom. A child may be hearing impaired if the easiest way is using a hearing aid. Now, that means that child has been already medically diagnosed and using hearing aid in your classroom. So therefore, you already know that this child is having some kind of hearing problem. But there could be children who have not been medically diagnosed or identified. So for those children, we need to keep certain points in mind. One is if the child speaks very loudly in the class. Now, this happens when the children are not able to hear. Because they can't hear their voice, they tend to speak very loudly. Also, the child keeps coming in the front. It keeps coming to you because wants to listen to you or to any source of voice. So that's another indicator that the child is not able to hear at that point where the child is sitting. Keeps asking her friends to repeat. Now, it generally happens with the children with hearing impaired that they miss on certain points which have been told to you. They are not able to hear complete thing. And so they keep disturbing their friends with the intent that they should repeat for them. So in that case, we need to understand they are not disturbing their friends, but they are trying to understand what you are saying. Another point is they might be very restless in the class, or they might seem confused. Now, this is precisely because they are not able to hear what you have said. So they are not able to establish a continuity with what you are saying. And therefore, sometimes they get restless in the class. What to do now, because I am not able to hear? Or they might get confused because they heard something and they missed the next thing, and you moved on to the third thing, and they are not able to find the second thing itself. So they are not able to establish connection between what you said first and what you said at the third position. And therefore, they won't be able to concentrate also. Another point is they don't respond when her name is called. So when you call her name, they don't sometimes respond in one go, you know, because they didn't hear your voice. It's not there that they are ignoring you, but that means there is some problem with their hearing. Often asked to increase the volume of audio or video played in the class. So they would request you that, can we have at a louder volume? Now, you need to differentiate why they are saying so. Is it that they have some problem with hearing, or it's because of some other reason? But hearing problem could be one of the reasons that the child is asking for you to increase the audio or video. Tries to come near the audio or video device. So again, the source of voice, the sound, is that device. So the child tries to come near to hear clearly. Maybe the child is able to hear, but not clearly. So in that case, again, you need to differentiate that why the child is coming near to the device instead of just telling the child to go back to the seat. Because in that case, we won't be able to understand the child's need. Often looks at others' faces very intently as if trying to read the face or lip read. Now, children with hearing impairment most of the times are using their vision, are trying to read what you are on your facial expressions or your lips in order to make out, comprehend what you are saying, because they are not able to hear the entire thing. So it's important that you see that if there are those children in your class who are looking at each other, who are looking at others' faces very intently, especially the face of the person who is speaking, that means that child is having some problem with hearing. Doesn't get disturbed by the loud noises because they are not able to hear the voice or the noise, and therefore loud noises are not able to affect them. And so that's another indicator for you as a teacher that the child couldn't hear, and that's why the loudness of noise is not affecting the child. Gives irrelevant or weird answers to the questions. Now, many a times you will see that some children give very irrelevant answer to a question that you asked, and sometimes we as teachers get irritated or we may get annoyed also. But we should understand that one of the possible reasons could be that the child didn't hear your question at all or heard it in such a way that the complete thing didn't get communicated to the child. And that's why an irrelevant answer or a weird answer. So that could be another indicator. Delay in language or speech development. Now we know that language development or speech development happens because we hear the language. So hearing the language is one of the main factors that helps in language or speech development in us. Now because they can't hear, so obviously their language or speech development gets delayed. Pronouncing certain words incorrectly. Again, because they are not able to hear, that's why they are not able to get the right pronunciation of certain words and may pronounce certain words incorrectly. So this way the list goes on for a teacher, and I'm very sure that as a teacher you would be sensitive enough to listen to these small indicators that help you to understand, help you to identify the needs of your children who are having hearing impairment. Hearing impairment is different from deafness, rather it includes deafness in it. How? Hearing impairment means any degree and type of auditory disorder, it could be of any kind. While deafness is very specific, it means an extreme inability to discriminate conversational speech through the ear. So children with hearing impairment are simply those who cannot use their hearing for communication. Children who are hard of hearing would have a lesser degree of hearing impairment, and children who are deaf, for them the sound must reach at least at 90 decibels. 90 decibels means 5 to 10 times louder than the normal speech at which we generally speak. Now, there are two types of hearing impairment as per the affected area. The first is the sensory neural hearing loss. It involves damage to the auditory pathways within the central nervous system. Now, what is this auditory pathway? As you know, the cochlea, which is the inner ear, that receives the sound. When we hear from our ears, the cochlea receives the sound and it transmits the sound through the auditory nerve to the brainstem and the cerebral cortex. Now, why cerebral cortex? Because cerebral cortex is the part of the brain which has the auditory zone in it, where the sound that you are hearing, that gets interpretation of itself, means you get the meaning of the sound that you are hearing. Now, this is a diagram of the auditory pathway. As you can see, the bottom part of the diagram shows the cochlea. It's a snail-like, very small object, and it's connected to the auditory nerve, which takes to the midbrain, and from the midbrain it goes on to the upper part of the diagram is actually the cerebral cortex, which has that auditory cortex in it, primary auditory cortex, which interprets what sound you are hearing. Now, this auditory pathway gets damaged or disrupted at any point for multiple reasons. The reasons could be any. Now, when it gets disrupted, the person is able to hear the sound but is not able to make meaning out of it, is not able to understand what kind of a sound it is, what is the sound saying to us. So the interpretation could not be done. The second is conductive hearing loss, which means damage to the outer or the middle ear. Because the damage is in the outer or middle ear, so it interferes with the sound waves reaching the cochlea. And therefore, the sound is not reaching to the person at all. The person is not able to hear any sound. Causes of hearing impairment are two types. One is the heredity, the other is environmental factors. Heredity, 50% of all the cases of deafness, genetic factors or heredity are probable causes of deafness. Environmental factors may include accidents, illness, ototoxic drugs, etc. Rubella or other viral infections contracted by the pregnant woman may deafen an unborn child. Hazards associated with process of birth, for example, a cutoff in the oxygen supply may again affect hearing. Illness or infection of any kind can also cause deafness in young children. Constant high noise level can cause progressive and eventually severe sensory and neural hearing loss. Tumors, exposure to explosive sound, injury to skull or ear could also lead to deafness. Now, factors that get influenced due to hearing impairment. Now, some children have hearing impairment, which is a difficulty to hear that we have been discussing, and therefore they may not be able to hear the sound, or they are not able to interpret, they hear the sound but they don't know what you are saying, right? So in this, what happens is the first thing obviously is the natural process of acquisition of language and speech therefore is prevented. So they are not able to speak clearly also. Now in that case, when they are not able to hear clearly, when they are not able to speak clearly, obviously their communication with others gets affected. Now the parents, obviously they try to understand them, but in the case of peer group or in the community, when they are not able to communicate, sometimes it happens that they are socially isolated. They are not able to communicate and interact with others, and this may lead to low self-esteem also. So as teachers, we have to understand this also. There's the child, we become a medium for the child to communicate with others so that the child is not socially isolated. What we can do as teachers for CWHI? CWHI, I like other students, we have to remember this, except that their faculty of hearing is affected. So therefore, they may not speak because they are not able to hear. So that's okay for us. We have to make them speak. They learn through their vision and to some extent their tactile and kinesthetic sense. And therefore, we should try that we should make these children sit in the front, preferably in the center, because as teachers, we tend to stand in the center of the class. So if they are standing, if they are sitting right in front of us, our voice is most probably going to reach them. Other thing is that helping the child look at the face of the person who is speaking. So if you are speaking, try to look at the child so that the child can read your face. Or if any other student in the class is speaking, tell the child to face towards the child who is having hearing impairment so that he could or she could see the child who is speaking. And for all this, it is important that there should be sufficient light in the classroom. If light is not sufficient, the child will not be able to see the face or lips of the other people clearly. And that would prevent the child from reading your lips or your facial expressions. Use of chalkboard and chart. So more of visual materials have to be used in the class because, you know, they depend more on visuals. And visuals, any case, help other children also. Encourage the child to wear the prescribed hearing aid all the time. Now, you as teachers may not be a specialized person, you know, but you can definitely facilitate the process. You can get in touch with the special educator, you can get in touch with their parents and see that the child gets the assistive device that the child needs. Through sign language. Now, sign language has been accepted as one of the languages for communication. So, that acceptance should be there in your classroom also, by you as a teacher also. So, if the child is comfortable in using the sign language, encourage the child to do so and encourage other children to try to understand that language so that that language, the child can use that language without any inhibition. A very interesting fact and a very latest news in this regard, which has come on 23rd March 2018, is that India's first ever sign language dictionary has been launched. And the Indian Sign Language Dictionary, it has been developed by the Indian Sign Language Research and Training Center, and it aims to bring uniformity in sign languages so that the graphic representations that we are using can be understood by the other person also in the same way. Now, one picture is there on the slide which shows one graphic representation of the sign language. It has 3000 English and Hindi words that have graphic representation for itself. So, it is a very interesting and a very important essential initiative by our government, and therefore, we as teachers need to promote this further and see that the children are using it, their parents are using it to develop an understanding of the sign language. Now, we come to the other part of our session, which is on children with speech impairment. Now, the rights of persons with disabilities, that is RPWD Act 2016, defines it as means a permanent disability arising out of conditions such as laryngectomy or aphasia affecting one or more components of speech and language due to organic or neurological causes. Now, laryngectomy means that due to some reason the larynx, which is the voice box, gets cut or gets damaged. And aphasia, both of them lead to some problem with the speech and language. Now, who are children with speech impairment in my classroom? They are one who are having problem with articulation. Articulation means production of speech sounds. Lisping is an articulation disorder. In this, what happens that the sound of S and Z gets replaced by the sound th. So, instead of school, they may say thul, right? Similarly, the R sound also gets affected. So, instead of rat, they may say vat. The second is they may have difficulty in voice. Voice means the pitch of the voice or the resonance or the loudness. So, either they may have totally voicelessness or they may have a chronic hoarseness in their voice. Third is, what is affected is fluency, the flow of speech. Now, we know when the flow of speech gets affected, it means stuttering or stammering, where the speech is not fluent. Now, this is actually involuntary. So, if the child is involuntary means it's not in child's control. So, if the child is involuntary repeating certain words, prolonging certain sounds, hesitating in between, pausing before the speech, all this, remember, are not happening because the child wants it to happen. It's happening involuntary with the child. So, for child also, it's very difficult to understand why it's happening in my speech. Right? So, stuttering or stammering has many psychological causes, and two majorly are anxiety and nervousness. So, this kind of stuttering or stammering generally increases when the child is anxious or nervousness. So, the more we try to calm down the child and give time to the child to speak, the better the child may speak. Next is speech or communication. Repetition of the words or phrases or cluttered speech, difficulties with pragmatics of speech, mean what to speak when, how to and which word to speak for your particular expression. So, here the problem is with the use of words and phrases, coming closer to what is also a problem in language, which is the next point. So, the child is not able to use the right kinds of words, that is inappropriate diction, or formulation of sentences. Sometimes the words would be jumbled in the sentences, or the sentence is not making any sense and is not able to comprehend what you say also, and also even you are not able to comprehend what the child has written. So, there the problem is either with the speech, while speaking the language is not correct, or even while communicating, the child is not able to say what the child wants to express. Now, the causes of speech impairment can be, one, if it is a delayed speech, the causes could be mental retardation or hearing impairment or behavioral disorders. So, other kinds of disabilities also lead to speech impairment. Then is cleft palate. Cleft palate, we know it's a structural defect in the palate, mouth and lip, because of which also physically the child is having problem in speaking, or it could be speech defects. Now, speech defects have many reasons. One could be emotional and psychological causes. Other is lack of stimulation, means the child didn't get stimulation to speak when the child started speaking, didn't get much opportunity to speak also. Maladaptive behavior such as hyperactivity, oral motor incoordination is inefficient communication in the areas of brain which are responsible, because it's the brain that sends signals which leads to a movement of the lips, even the movement of the internal organs, that's the voice box, and that's how the speech comes out. So there's some problem in that coordination, or it could be heredity. There is a syndrome which is called Fragile X syndrome, which has been associated with speech impairment. Now, factors that are influenced due to speech impairment, obviously, as we did it for the hearing impairment, they also have lots of problems in communication. People don't understand them, they don't give them time to speak, and therefore they may have negative social effects, especially among the young children who are the beginners, who have just started communicating and interacting with others. For them, it's all the more difficult because nobody is giving them time that they need to speak. And the other could be targets of bullying. Now, because they are not able to establish a cordial relationship with their friends, because they are not able to speak like their peers or their friends, so they may become targets of bullying. Other children may start bullying them, may start making fun of them. And that may affect their identity, that may result in decreased self-esteem in them. So in this case, the parents and the teachers have to play a major role so that the other children also become sensitive and they know that why it happens in certain children, it's not their fault, it is something related to medical issue which is there in their bodies. Now, what can we do as teachers for CWSI? The first thing is provide students with help and support to interact with their peers. Just now what we discussed. We have to become mediators for them so that they are able to establish a relationship with their friends. Their friends understand them better. They understand their needs. They understand how they are different and why they require more time to speak, why they should be heard for a longer time. Next is patient enlisting. The same applies to we as teachers. We have to be very patient with them. Give them time to speak. That will definitely decrease their anxiety levels. If they know that they have time to speak, they will not get anxious, they won't be in a hurry, and that will definitely ease out the process for them, and they would be able to communicate whichever way they want to. Alternative ways of expression is very important. We need to understand that language can be, speech can be replaced by non-verbal ways also. And so, therefore, if a child is using some gestures to communicate itself, that should be encouraged in the classroom. If the child wants to draw, illustrate, that should be encouraged in the classroom. If the child wants to make computer presentations or wants to make models, all that should get place in the classroom. Similarly, and the easiest way is that if the child wants to write and tell you something, please take it, please accept it. It's not necessary that everything has to be oral. We can do things in alternative ways also. Establishing a culture in the classroom to listen to each other. Now, this applies to everybody, but in particular to the children with speech impairment because they need more time. So, children should learn to wait for their turn to speak. They shouldn't speak in between because that disturbs all children, but particularly children with speech impairment. So, if they get more time, they will be able to communicate better. Seeking short answers from them wherever possible. Say that you can give this answer in one or two words so that they speak less but they communicate in those few words only. Coordinating with the speech therapist, special educators, parents, that is very important that you as a teacher are communicating with them all the time on a continuous basis and designing or planning strategies for the children in your classroom. So, after discussing about children with hearing impairment and speech impairment, we would conclude that we as teachers should try to understand the child first and not the impairment. The impairment is there, it has medical reasons for it, but the child has many other abilities other than that impairment. Impairment, whether hearing or speech, may be due to a variety of causes and may lead to different manifestations in different children. So, we as teachers have to understand that each child with hearing impairment or speech impairment would look different to us. And therefore, we have to understand this diversity. Teachers can identify the needs of these children in her class through her observations also. This is very important. We shouldn't wait for the medical diagnosis. We should start the very first day seeing and identifying the needs of the children and what issues they are having in hearing or speech, if there are any. As teachers, we need to use specific strategies in the class that are sensitive to the unique needs of the children with hearing impairment and speech impairment and would help all children in the class. It will help in bringing universal designs in our classroom and make our class a more inclusive space. So hope you like this session, and somewhat you have, I've been able to communicate my concerns and my issues, my understandings about children with special needs. And you will be able to implement some of it in your day-to-day practice. I'm sure you are going to do a very good work in this. So thank you for now, and we'll meet in the next session. These are three readings which you can look at for this particular session or topic. Thank you.